In our congregation this morning, we have many people who are trying to find happiness and joy and comfort. Many of the people of the great state of West Virginia have lost sight of what true peace is all about. Our nation is struggling with the concept of what right and wrong truly means. The whole world has lost sight of why they were created and what their purpose is. To start our worship service this morning, we filled the baptistry and assisted three of our young ones on their journey with Jesus. We clapped and laughed and grinned from ear to ear, and our hearts were filled with God-given joy. This is one of the things that an active, Bible-believing, and Christ-centered church is supposed to do. We've been given the responsibility to help those who are trying to figure out this guy called Jesus. You know, there's a lot of questions out there. Who is he? What does he really do for us? Why do we follow him? Too many people are still confused about Jesus Christ and even confused about the purpose of the church today. Too many people reject his teachings and run their lives according to whatever they want, all the while never considering that the 70 to 80 years of life here on earth can't compare to the forever of eternity that we will live in the afterlife. Amen. So what matters most? The here and now or eternity? What we want to do or what God wants us to do? So I'm going to ask each of you that are here today, this morning, for you to do something for yourselves. Please, for the sake of your soul, I want you to keep your hearts and minds open to the teachings of God this morning. When you allow the Holy Spirit to take root, it is then that love will break through to you in such a way that you will be changed from the inside out. Your thoughts will change, your attitude will change, your action will change, all for the better, and God will make you smile. This morning, in the midst of everything else that has happened in your life, my prayer for each person here today is that you will let God's love break through. Let's ask you to do that, shall we? Let's pray together. Father, it's simple. We ask that your love break through. Break through barriers for some people, walls for others. Break through heartaches, hardships. Break through things that happened in years past that are just causing them, that they just can't let go and they can't come back to you. God, they can. Let love break through. Show us how. Please, please, oh God, show us how this morning. In the name of Jesus we pray, and all God's children said,
amen.
If you have your Bibles, I need you to go to 1 Samuel, Old Testament, chapter 3. We're going to use as our backbone of our story today, Samuel. Samuel's a little boy at this point. He's a young guy. And what we're going to see is that even at that earlier age, and I'm going to say 10, 13, somewhere in there, that's what I'm thinking. God can change us. And he can also change us at the age of 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, 90, and anything in between. And that's what I want everybody to hear today. When we allow the love of God to break through whatever barrier that we still have up, things change in your life, and they change for the better. Amen?
Amen.
They really do. So what we are going to read is chapter 3, starting with verse 1, going to 11a. The boy Samuel ministered before the Lord under Eli. In those days, the word of the Lord was rare. There were not many visions. One night, Eli, whose eyes were becoming so weak that he could barely see, was laying down in his usual place. The lamp of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was lying down in the house of the Lord where the ark of God was. And then the Lord called Samuel. And Samuel answered, "Here I am." And he ran to Eli and said, "Here I am. You called me." But Eli said, "I did not call. Go back and lie down." So he went and lay down. Again, the Lord called, "Samuel." And Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, you called me." My son, Eli said, I did not call you. Go back and lie down. Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord. The word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him. A third time the Lord called Samuel. And Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, here I am, you called me. Then Eli realized that the Lord was calling the boy. So Eli told Samuel, go and lie down, and if he calls you, say, speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. So Samuel went and lay down in his place. The Lord came and stood there, calling as at the other times, Samuel, Samuel. Then Samuel said, speak, for your servant is listening. And the Lord said to Samuel, dot, dot, dot. And may God add his blessing to the reading of his word today. Interesting, isn't it? Wow. Then Samuel said, speak, for your servant is listening. Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. And the Lord said to Samuel all that he needed to say. This is a pure picture of someone not knowing God and his voice. He thought it was Eli three times. He thought it was the man who was basically his father three times. Eli figured it out and told him to say, speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. You know, sometimes in our lives, we must listen to God. Truly listen to God. In our fast-paced world, our society wants you to believe that there isn't much time to listen to God. You just don't have time to listen to God. You're too busy. That's what culture wants you to believe. You're too busy going here, there, and all over the place. But my brother and my sister, this morning, I want you to hear me say, you have as much time to listen to and for God as you desire. You who are seeking Jesus, you don't know him yet. You haven't asked him to be your personal Savior and Lord. Guess what? Listen for him this morning. And you who are already followers of Christ, listen to him. And when you do, when we do, you see there's a connection that occurs. And I really mean that, a connection. The joining together of two, you and God. Because ultimately, and it's happening every second of every day of your life, God is pursuing you. Do you think that the God who created you, that loves you more than anybody, is going to sit back and not try to nurture you? Not try to get you to understand that there are things that he wants you to do that are better than the things that you are doing? God is pursuing you. And he's pursuing you in such a way that it is only for your benefit. Folks, he pursued Samuel. Samuel, in his young age and in not knowing, mistook him three times for Eli. Could you picture that? He runs back in. Here I am. You called me. Eli said, I didn't call you, dude. Go back. Go back to bed. That's like you who are parents. And you got the little ones when they're first, you know, growing up. You finally get them into their own bed. And then they get up and say, Mommy, there's something in my bed. No, there's not. Go back to bed. Oh, no, you've got to come and look. No, you know, go back to bed. Go back to bed. Go back to bed. Over and over and over. It got to the point where, you know, our door would open up. Neither one of us would even get up out of bed. Wouldn't even get up like this. We'd just say, go back to bed. And they just turned around, the door slowly closed, and went back to bed. All right? God's pursuing Samuel. God pursued Samuel not just three times, but an additional time, the fourth time. I truly believe, in my humble estimation, God is pursuing you, and he is pursuing you with all that he is. Again, society is going to tell you that you're not worthy to be pursued by God. And that God will not worry about you and what's going on in your lives. And I'm telling you, he does. He doesn't worry. He knows what's going on in your life. How you are reacting to it. He wants you to react as a godly man or a godly woman would. God cares for you, folks. He cares for us all. He knows how many hairs are on your head. How many freckles are on your face. He knows how many teeth are in your head, man. And you know, I mean, he knows everything about you. And he knows right where you are. He knows that some of you aren't doing well financially, others are doing great. Some of you aren't doing well emotionally, others are doing great. Some of you aren't doing well spiritually, others are doing great. He knows you very well. In fact, he knows you better than anybody else because he flat out smoking loves you. Period. I even wrote it out, period. He loves you. This whole thing, if there's a connection, it begins with God and it ends with you. And by that, I mean that you control the connection. In just a second, there's going to be a song that we're going to play over our sound system. There'll be words on it. And you've got the words right here. You might want to get this out. Because I want you to know that the connection is all about. You can stay away from God or choose to draw near to Him. You can run and you can try to hide, or you can wrap yourself inside of His loving hug. You can live in the darkness, or you can live in the light. I absolutely believe that Toby Mac is a genius. He's a contemporary artist who's been around for years. You guys know he's 50 years old now. He's in his 50s. And he still rocks the world. But the words that he writes, the songs that he does, I've loved him ever since DC Talk. And I want to tell you, he's better now than he ever has been. And this song, this love breaking through, listen to the words as he sings it. You're only going to see the words. Listen to it, and let's share it right now. God is pursuing you. It all begins with Him, but it comes back, and you've got to be a partner in this. God is pursuing you. You see, the song said He draws us out of darkness. God found Him in the darkness and drew Him out of the shadows. How many here today needs that to happen to them? God's arrow of love hit the mark and changed him forever. I know that it can happen. It happened to me. Folks, remember that God sees in the darkness. He sees everything. And He wants you to come out of the darkness and be a man or woman of light. John 3:21 says this, "But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light, so that it may be seen plainly that what he has been done through God." God is waiting for you to come out of the darkness because you do matter to God. You matter to God. And what irritates me to the most, makes me upset and angry, is that everybody else tells you you don't matter. And you do. You matter. You matter to God. God's scripture is full of God saying the opposite. The woman at the well. Blind Bartimaeus. The Roman centurion. Lazarus. The four men who lowered the man into the house that the man was on the mat. And the guy on the mat. They all mattered to God. The 10 lepers. The beggar at the wall. The Israelites in the hands of the Egyptians. Mordecai. The widow's dead son, and more and more and more. I could take 20 minutes and just keep naming names because they all matter to God. Oh, wait a minute. Here's somebody else who matters to God. The person who is at Kroger's that you run into. Oh, wait a minute. How about the person that's next door to you in your work cubicle? Oh, wait a minute. How about the person who sits to the right and left of you at the movie theater? Oh, wait a minute. You. You matter to God. You really do. See, I was one of those people that said, God doesn't know me. God doesn't care about me. Because nobody had ever introduced him to me. And I just thought, well, then I didn't matter to him. So I don't want him. If he doesn't want me, I don't want him. And as a senior in high school, it all changed. We matter to God now and forever. You are important. So once you get that into your head, once we all understand, no matter if we have Christ in our heart or not, guess what? We've got to stop and praise. I want us to smell the roses. That's an old saying. It's been around for eons and eons. And what it really means is many people admire roses. Women, how many of y'all like to get roses? How many like to receive roses? Yeah, there's several of you. How many of us like to look at roses? I love to look at roses. I really do. But as we look at a rose, we can be way out here and look at a rose. And, oh, that's a pretty rose bush. You keep going. What smell the roses means that wants us to stop being too busy. Quit being too busy. And literally stoop down and smell them. You can even get your hand and get the wind to blow and the fragrance comes to your nostrils. And smell them. Savor the smell. Too many times we're in too much of a rush. Too many times we've got to be here, there, and everywhere. And we can't stop to say, oh, wait a minute, thank you, God. I've encouraged this church to, before their feet hit the floor coming out of bed, Your alarm goes off, and you've got to get to work, you've got to get the kids up, you've got to get breakfast going, you've got to get clothes ready, you've got to get lunches ready, you've got to. Before you even leave, man, get out of the bed, before you ever touch the floor, stop and say, God, thank you for a good, nice rest, thank you for my bed, thank you for what's going to happen today. You be with me, lead, guide, and direct me. In the name of Christ, give Him the day. Stop and smell the roses. And if we do that, guess what? Great praises will occur. I can't get over this book. I don't have anything marked. Pray. praises will occur. Thank you, my Lord, for being with me always. My soul cries out for answers, but you're there to answer, O God. I cried out to you, Lord. I whimpered, I wailed to you, but you were there. I laughed and you laughed with me, Lord. I praise you from deep inside. Praise be to you, our Father, for the opportunities to be your hands and feet. We praise you, Lord, for giving us these children. You see what I'm doing? I'm spinning, and this is full of praise. Thanks be to the glory of God for the rolling oceans, the white billowing clouds, the smell of fresh mowed grass and falling snow. Don't you think that's praises? How about this one? Daily we struggle with the ways of the world, but you are always there. You are our Lord and Savior. Strengthen us when we are at our weakest. Guide us as we attempt to make better choices. I go on and on. We need to be in that frame of mind continuously. Praise God. Stop and smell the roses. Because when you do, you're going to receive the joy. If you got something, write it in, joy. Joy is a very glad feeling, great pleasure and delight. Put it in there somewhere on your notes. A very glad feeling, great pleasure, delight. When you allow God's love to break through to you, you will receive joy. Now, this joy is not the joy of the world. And that's what people don't understand. It's a different joy. It's a different joy. This joy is deep in your soul. It changes you from the inside out. It goes to the very essence of who you are. We should cry out to God for His love. We should scream from the mountaintop for His love. We should ask for it in a whisper of a prayer. We should be always, constantly talking to Him about His love for us and our love for Him. Great pleasure. Give me great pleasure, O God. Give me a delight. Delight my soul today, Father. Allow me to feel you even in the tough things I have to do at work. I have to let somebody go today, O God. They're going to hear it. They've got two kids and a wife, and they're going to have to be let go. It's not fun. It's part of my job. But somehow, let me do the things that are positive to make it easy. And when we do all of that, we're going to count our blessings. Count our blessings. Man. A blessing is the gift of divine favor. Have you ever asked for blessings? Bless me, oh God. You see, Don't come to me for blessings. I'm your pastor. I don't have the power to give you blessings. I can say, God, please bless them. Bless Josiah and Hunter and all the other ones that will be going to college very soon.
Amen.
Okay? I can ask God to. I can't bless you all. It's not in me. Nobody. God is the only one that can give blessings. We can ask for them. The thing that is, you don't ask for them. And neither do I enough. Genesis chapter 32. Jacob is cool. Listen to these words and see how much he wanted a blessing. That night, Jacob got up and took his two wives, his two female servants, and his 11 sons across the ford of Jabbok. After he had sent them across the stream, he sent over all of his possessions. So Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him till daybreak. When the man saw that he could not overpower him, he touched the socket of Jacob's hip so that his hip was wrenched as he wrestled with the man. Then the man said, "Let me go, for it's daybreak." But Jacob replied, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." The man asked him, "What's your name?" "Jacob," he answered. Then the man said, "Your name will no longer be Jacob, but Israel, because you have struggled with God and with humans and have overcome." And Jacob said, "Please tell me your name." But he replied, "Why do you ask my name?" And then he blessed him there. Jacob held on to God until he blessed him. I'm not trying to be funny. He grabbed a hold of him and he wouldn't let go until he blessed him. He blessed him. And I want to tell you all, we don't do that enough. When was the last time you just said, "God, I will not let go of you until you bless me, until you give me joy, until you give me a deep peace inside. I'm struggling. give it to me. I think that our interaction with God has got to ratchet up a couple notches. I think we've got to be doing that. Because if we're going to count our blessings, we've got to be serious about it. You know, you that are already believers and followers of Christ, think of all the blessings that you've had since you accepted Him. Countless. 18, 60, 72 years that I've been with Jesus.
You're not 72.
It took y'all long enough on that one. Okay?
You're blessed.
A third, 42 years since I've been with Jesus. And there's so many blessings, big and small. We forget the small ones. We do. But we can remember the big ones. And you that are seeking Jesus this morning, God has blessings ready to give you. His arms are full. They're loaded. And He wants to come over and just start dumping them on you. Giving them. But you've got to be a part of Him. You've got to have that Christ thing, that Jesus thing. I tell people that when we become Christians, when we become followers of Christ, I think there's a moment in our lives when God literally backs up a dump truck. And you know, if you really are awake, you can hear it. Beep, 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 beep. And He dumps blessings upon us by the dump truck. And if we stay with Him, if we're one with Him, yeah, there's going to be tough times come in our lives. But He will navigate us through those very difficult mazes. And with that, we count another blessing. I just want you to celebrate change. Celebrate change. Paul, on the road to Damascus, celebrated change. He was knocked off his horse, and he was changed right there. God changed him. How about the man that was lame, and Jesus healed him? What do you think he did? He got up. He never walked before, and he got up, and he said, "Thank you so much, kind sir," and walked on. Shoot fire. He'd been jumping up and down, kicking his legs all over the place, and running around, telling everybody. How about the man who received sight? You know, Jesus spit, took all that mud, put it on his eyes, and all of a sudden, bam! You think that he wasn't happy about it? We've got to celebrate the change. So how will you celebrate the change today when you allow God's love to enter in? You see, I truly believe that when love breaks through, you celebrate by learning to walk. And the walk is your journey with Jesus. A couple weeks ago, I was going into Go-Mart. True story. Going into Go-Mart, I was going to buy a Coke or something. I was getting out of my car, and this dude was walking in. Now, I kid you not. He had his pants, had his belt on his pants. Now, I'm serious. That's the lowest I've ever seen. It was down here. Now, he still had his long shirt on, so I couldn't see his underwear. But I want to show you his walk. I'm serious. He got his legs out wide, and then the guys with no belts, you know, he's doing this. And I'm thinking, buddy, that is the dumbest thing I've seen in a long time. You know, got to the door. I wanted to call him a little crab or something. You know how they move sideways? I just thought, gee whiz, dude, that's not the walk that God's talking about. All right? The walk that God's talking about is your journey with Christ. Become His student. Who in here like going to school? Yeah, you like going to school. Okay, now, there's nothing wrong with that. Okay, I like going to school. Now, hang on. I like going to school. How many of y'all like studying? Jerry and Jeffries. Oh, Carla. Okay, y'all just weird. Okay, I love you. No, y'all just good students. Me, I couldn't stand studying. I love going to school. I love seeing my friends. I love sports and all that. I love gym class. Hey, it was good. It was great. I mean, I love that stuff. I love that. It was great. But when you had to become a student, it was like, oh man, this is off that. But we got to start going back to school. We've got to start learning again. We've got to start embracing God's Word. And by that, we've got to take His Word, and we literally have to start opening it up and reading it. Start going into it. Using it. Making it a part of who we are. It is necessary for us to do that. 2 Timothy 2:15 says this, "Do your best to present yourself to God as one approved, a worker who does not need to be ashamed and who correctly handles the word of truth." If you look at that, that's a very powerful scripture. It's saying, get up and get on with it. Be a worker who correctly handles the word of truth. So we've got to make time to learn. We've got to set aside some time, and we've got to seek opportunities to become strong. Now, by that, I mean, look for learning opportunities to get strong in your beliefs. Like this next week, even on Friday, our youth, 17 youth and 5 adult leaders. That is awesome, man, going on a charge up. How about a learning opportunity right there? Learning opportunities, home groups. There's 6 of them, 1 brand new one. We got 6. How about worship services? Can you learn about becoming stronger in God by going to a contemporary Christian or a Christian concert? Absolutely. Man, I'm a Toby Mac fan. Can you get stronger by going to conventions, by going to Christian movies? Yes, you can, but you've got to put yourself into those situations and not just say, boy, I'd like to go, but do it. Because when you do, and you do all these things, and when love breaks through, and you've got your connection, and you're stopping, and you're praising, and you're learning to walk, then you need to go out and rock the world. Carpe diem, man. Who knows what that means, everybody? Seize the day. Seize the day. And I don't think we do that enough. Seize the day. We don't seize it, we just walk out into it. We don't expect to alter history or to make new history. We just go day by day if we are incapable of being used by God to make something extraordinary to occur. And that's not what my Lord has taught me through His scriptures. Through Him, all things are possible. Everybody say, all things are possible.
All things are possible.
One more time, all things are possible.
All things are possible.
Not just some things, all things. Not just a few things, all things. Not just all things. And I want you to know that. Today only comes once. August 6, 2017. Only one time. Tomorrow is only going to come once. God wants each of us to seize the day. Grab it. Own it. Grow in it. God is yelling from His heavenly throne, do this for me. Let people know, all of the world, that I exist and Jesus is real. Tell them there's only one way into my street of gold, one way to my throne room, one way to live forever in my paradise, and that is by accepting my Son as your Savior. Seize the day, seize the day, seize the day. God, through you, making amazing things. So it brings us to the back part of our scripture with Samuel. Now he's already been called. And he's already talked to God. And God told him some stuff. Chapter 3, 19-4:1. The Lord was with Samuel as he grew up. And he let none of Samuel's words fall to the ground. And all Israel from Dan to Beersheba recognized that Samuel was attested as a prophet of the Lord. The Lord continued to appear in Shiloh, and there he revealed himself to Samuel through his word. And Samuel's word came to all Israel. God is with you. God is with each of us. If we have Jesus as our Savior, God is with us, and He's telling us to do something. What? Take it to your people first. Your people. Take it to your family first. Baptizing little ones and seeing families come, it makes me smile. But what would make me as the pastor smile even more is that if everybody was back next week and the week after and the week after. That says more to God than coming and being a supportive family, friends, for a little guy, a little girl. So make a plan. Make a plan, you that are saved, to take the gospel to your family, to the ones that we love the most. Is it hard? Absolutely. It is very hard. But all things are possible with God and through God. And then we need to take it and make it an everyday thing everywhere. And Samuel's word came to all Israel. And it could say, and Rebecca's word came to all of West Virginia. And Billy's word came to all of Nitro. And Sheila's word went out to all the high schools. If we make this an all the time thing, then God's love that has broken through becomes who we are. It becomes second nature at that point. And if we do it so often and it just flows out of our mouths and then people see it in our actions, then you're going to draw others to Jesus. So I end with this. Don't put anything up. Are you still trying to find happiness in the Lord? Are you hoping that a plate full of joy materializes right in front of you so you can take some home? Are you putting all of your ability to hear on what society says is worth listening to? Or are you still looking for something more? Well, let me tell you three things, and then I'll end in prayer. Number one, Jesus is the happiness you're looking for. Number two, the only joy that matters comes from giving your life to God and allowing Him to lead your life here and into eternity. Number three, the only more that you need is Jesus Christ, because He has everything that matters, and His truck, that dump truck, is on, and He's got it in reverse, and He wants to back up to you. So are you willing to accept all that's necessary through Jesus Christ to be happy, to be full of joy, and to have everything that God needs you to have? I hope so. Let's pray together.